Welcome to the loudest podcast on the internet. The only podcast that was started before the quarantine began. That's true. That's statistics. Look it up. This is the only podcast that began before the quarantine. Amazon is sold out of podcasting mics. Did you know that?
Yes, I do.
That's how bad this is.
It's a national content emergency. Oh, the thing that pisses me off is that Amazon is sold out of web cameras because, like, everybody, I need a webcam for my kids so my kids can go to school. I need a webcam for the loudest podcast, okay?
Who the fuck needs a webcam to go to school?
Every child in America?
Can't they just listen?
You know what? Asked and answered. That's a good point. Why can't they just listen? That's a really good point.
That would be great.
What, no, you gotta see these kids nodding? I guess, how will you know that they raised their hand?
That's true. How would they know you're not cheating? But then again, you could just, like, tape all the answers to your little wall. You could wallpaper the area in front of your desk with, like, formulas, like Y equals MC squared. Wait, no, I've been so divorced from education or math, I can't think of a single quadratic formula or anything.
I also could not think of a single formula that I would need on my wall at any point in time.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Y equals MX plus B. That's a line, right?
I don't know.
Y equals X squared. That's a, what's it called? A parabola, right?
I don't know. I do know that it takes 2 gold nuggets to make the golden candlesticks, which are worth 20,000 bells in Animal Crossing.
Let me tell you, did you hear about that guy that was like, Animal Crossing, it subconsciously it plays to a woman's desire to be dominated.
I'm sorry, what?
Wait, give me a second.
Okay.
Make sure I can find it.
While Sirancha is looking this up, I'll tell you guys, hey, thank you so much for listening. Something that we would love if you could do is to go on iTunes and give us a good review. We'd like 5 stars, but iTunes says we're not allowed to ask for 5 stars. Some shit like that. iTunes has rules.
How would they ever know if we asked?
I don't know. I heard a long time ago that iTunes has, like, one guy working for the podcast department.
I believe that.
Yeah, and it's like, you better know that one guy's email. All right, but anyway, did you find the thing?
Oh, I have no idea where it is. It's lost to the annals of Facebook history.
The conceit of it was,
like, Animal Crossing is liberal propaganda.
Love
because it involves owning the earth while also sharing it with some kind of like land ownership theory.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Sure.
Yeah.
Whatever. I get it. It's like, that's one of the things I don't like about the internet is how everyone's just like, current trend plus my political opinions. Like, how the pandemic, blah, 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 libertarianism. How the new Super Smash Brothers game, blah, 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 communism.
Is racist.
Yeah, exactly. I'm trying to think of like another, how slap bracelets, blah, 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 feminist theory. It's like, okay, I get it.
Has anybody complained yet about how when you need to dig on the beach looking for Gulliver's communicator parts, it kind of looks like those trypophobia? Like when they edit the lotus pods onto like people's hands and it looks like they have, you know what trypophobia is, right?
I believe that's a fear of holes.
Yes, it's a fear of clustered holes very close together.
I didn't know it was that specific.
Yeah, no, and it
I thought it was like you'd go into a Blockbuster Video, see the movie Holes, and then piss yourself.
I mean, you probably would. And the people, in my experience, I'm sure this is not the case with everybody. In my experience, people that have that are just baby bitches who like to complain.
Everybody wants to have their thing. Yeah. Like, oh, I don't eat anything that has a, I don't eat any animal that has a face. Like, oh, I can't go in the deep end of a place. Everybody wants to be interesting and nobody's Asterios Coconuts.
Nobody's Sirancha either. God, what are you excited for after this quarantine's over? What are you most excited to be able to do in real life again?
You know, it's difficult because as a sober person, I wasn't having fun anyway. Like, everyone's like, oh, I want to go out and go to the bars and party and this and that. I'm like, I don't know. I guess I want to be able to play Animal Crossing at a Denny's. I don't know. As As a sober person, my whole life is a prison.
You gotta get a case for that thing now, because I bet that's gonna be a lot of fun to play on the train.
I played it the other day on the subway. And the only reason I did it is because the subways are now completely empty. I had to go into town to get some cruelty-free mouse traps. Because now that I've seen the mouse that we have in our kitchen, it's too cute to kill.
It's tiny. It's one. We have one mouse in our kitchen. He's very tiny.
We have one mouse in our kitchen, which honestly in New York is a blessing. Because like the buildings are made of rats in New York.
Yeah, we got a real nice apartment.
Yeah, I really fucking like this place.
I'm amazing we haven't seen a mouse since we lived here.
Yeah, we've been in this apartment for like 3 years. Now we have a mouse. He's a dead ringer for Remy the mouse. Now, I know that you're going to say, Remy's a rat.
He is a rat.
But he's not. I think he's a little mouse. He looks a lot like rats are vicious. Rats are the tigers of the walls. Mine's are cute.
Rats are big.
Yeah, I know. So that's the
rats
thing.
Rats are scary.
You got I'm down there. I'm down at the Kohl's. They have mouse traps and rat traps. You can also use the rat traps to catch squirrels and raccoons.
Oh, my God. I'm going to throw up.
Yeah, exactly. But, and look, is this hypocritical? Yes. Have I killed thousands of chickens in my never-ending quest to be satisfied, to become a human McNugget? Yes. Like, have I eaten veal before, which is, like, even more adorable than lamb? Wait, what is veal, lamb?
Veal is, like, the evilest meat you can eat. It's baby calf.
It's little baby calf.
Yeah, lamb is just lamb.
Okay, I get it. I've eaten veal. I've eaten all the... Look, I've made eye contact with the mouse. It's over now. It's kind of like how Timon and Pumbaa had that rule. They're not allowed to eat anything that has talked to them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because Timon and Pumbaa, they'll eat bugs all fucking day. But if a bug goes like, hey, please don't eat me, that's where Timon and Pumbaa draw the line, baby.
Yeah, it's weird. Like, sometimes late at night, I'll think about the rules in these cartoon universes on what is an intelligent animal and what isn't. Because something that pisses me off about Paw Patrol is that... Okay, so I hate it when there are not clearly defined rules as to what is an intelligent animal and what isn't. Because, okay, if you've never seen Paw Patrol, it's about a little Mexican kid and a bunch of puppies. And the puppies each have a superpower, or they can operate machinery or something. And there's puppies and then there's cats. And the cats and the puppies have, like, basically human intelligence. Like, they can talk to one another. They can communicate. They can work together. They can solve abstract problems and understand concepts. But then there are also other animals, like goats, that are not intelligent, I guess, because at one episode of Paw Patrol I've seen, they have to, their goats get stuck on like the top of a barn or something, and they have to like fire, they have to like get a cherry picker to get the goats down from the top of the building. And I just don't understand, is it just cats and dogs then? Is it just cats and dogs that can talk to you and communicate? Or are there other animals? Is it just goats? Because there are also bears.
And bats.
Yes.
There were bats in the mayor's purse. There were bears sleeping inside the convenience store. Now, I want to say, I think we've discussed Paw Patrol before, so I don't want to talk about this too much on the show. But, like, it is weird how it's like the dogs are so smart that they put on clothes, have beach picnics, and operate tanks, and goats are so stupid, they won't get off a roof, even though it's kind of like, there's nothing for you up on that roof, guy. There's not like there's eucalyptus up there. You're not having fun on the... How did you get on the roof?
You know what else is interesting to think about is the moral implications of movies where dogs can talk, but they still have a subservient role to humans.
That's a really fucking good point.
Like Beverly Hills Chihuahua. I'm always very interested in how these movies about talking dogs make it okay in kids' minds that the dogs are basically property. Like, yeah, they're basically property of humans. And it's either one of two things. It's either the dogs are super intelligent and have realized that they can gain a societal benefit by pretending that they are dumb animals, yes, that the humans own, or they like being slaves.
Which are the same, which are kind of two sides of the same coin. I was going to say the same thing. Like, the dogs are like, ah, it's a dog's life. Not allowed to go outside, consider someone else's property. If I die, I'm quickly replaced. If I get sick and it's too expensive to keep me, I'll die. Ah, to be a dog.
Yeah, the dogs versus cats movie, I think, does it best. Because that in the, those movies, like, the dogs have underground networks.
Yes.
Where, but they've realized that if they pretend to be dumb animals, then they get to live in the house and they get fed constantly. The Beverly Hills Chihuahua movies are the worst, though, because in those, they're just like, wow, I love to be a slave. Isn't it great to not be allowed outside except when my human lets me?
I do. But again, to be fair to the specific animals in Beverly Hills Chihuahua, they're living in Beverly Hills, baby. Like, You know, that movie opens with the song Mambo Number 5. That's how you know you're having a good time. If Mambo Number 5's playing, they don't play Mambo Number 5 at a funeral. I mean, maybe they'll play it at Lou Bega's funeral, but even then I might be like, this might not be the right time for Mambo Number 5.
Man, how pissed off would you be if you were a dog and you had to work? Like
the Paw Patrol dogs do?
Yeah, like your brother's, the golden retriever's at home licking his balls, and you have to go to the airport at 3 a.m. to sniff packages. Like, how fucking pissed off would you be?
IRL dog job.
Yeah,
also, like, police dogs. Like, being a fucking police dog is terrible because, like, if you witness your fellow police dog committing a murder, you've got, like, the blue wall of silence. And, like, imagine, like, if, like, the dogs from Internal Sniff Air show up and they're asking questions and you're like, you know, hey, it's us versus them out there. It's us versus them. You know, who are the real gangs? The gangs or the cops?
And fun fact, police shoot dogs a lot.
Yeah, I know.
If you didn't know that, like, yeah, look it up. There are statistics on this. So imagine, like, if a cop's gonna shoot someone, most of the time it's not with the intention to kill them. If a cop shoots a dog, it's to fucking kill the dog. And imagine if you're a dog and you have to watch on basically a weekly basis a cop literally murdering, like, pulling out a gun and shooting a dog with the intention of ending that dog's life.
Oh my God, you're right. You're party to dog murder as a canine cop. Goodness fucking gracious. Okay. Just back to Paw Patrol real quick, yeah. Even though I'm the one that said that we've already talked about it before. The kid's name is Ryder?
I think so.
What's he doing all day? He's in fucking management. He's a fucking fat cat, and there are fat cats in the show.
Ryder fucking sucks. Ryder needs to get his shit in order. I would be fucking pissed if I was Everest and Ryder called me, and then I didn't even need to go on the mission.
Which happens all the time.
Every fucking
Paw Patrol, everybody get to the fucking base. Okay, we have nothing to do with bulldozing today, so Rubble, you just watch. It's like he was at a picnic. Ryder never calls on the Paw Patrol when they're all just like, hey, I was nothing to do.
Yeah.
The Paw Patrol's never like, oh, I hope someone's in danger. They're always doing it. They're at the movies. They're at a candy festival. They're always doing it. I wish all stories didn't have to start in media res.
The Paw Patrol needs to figure the fuck out how to give each member of the Paw Patrol their own beeper.
Yes.
Because Ryder, it's not a fucking surprise. Like, they don't arrive at the job and they're like, oh shit, we need a bulldozer. We didn't realize that. Every single time, the plan goes off without a hitch, and every single time, they call all of the Paw Patrol members only to send 66% of them home.
Also, they make them all change.
Yeah, that's true.
They get in the elevator, all of a sudden they're all in their outfits, and then just some of them stay in the command center. Ryder, again, he needs to get his shit together. Also, get a little airplane or something. How about you get a rocket snowboard ride? Fucking do something. Wait a minute. Is Ryder like their agent? Maybe that's Ryder's importance, is like he's got connect. He's like the, He's like that. Wait, what's the name of Trump's son-in-law? Jared. He's like the Jared Kushner of the Paw Patrol. He just has friends and is well connected.
Oh my God. What if we got Joe Biden? So what if we got Hunter to fight Jared? He would do it. He totally would.
I think Hunter wants to fight Donald Trump.
Hunter wants to fight some. Didn't he get arrested for crack or something?
Yeah, he did. He got arrested for drugs. Like, one of the Biden kids was like an incredibly straight arrow, was like an attorney general. Then the Iraq War happened. He joined the military. Then he died of like a terrible cancer. And the other one is Hunter Biden. Like, we lost good Biden. And I know that's a very rare turn of phrase.
Yeah.
But I was thinking the other day about the Kennedys. Because everyone's always like, oh, the Kennedy curse, the Kennedy curse. Oh, this one fucking died. This one got shot. This one died like this. This one died in a playground. Oh, the Kennedy curse. Oh, Chappaquiddick. I don't think it's that the Kennedys are cursed. I think it's just that, like, when you're rich, you go on a lot of airplanes and you go to a lot of parties and you drive in a lot of cars and you're just out a lot. And, like, I think it's just like when you're rich, you have a much, like, the chances of us dying in a private plane crash are one in a million.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I never thought about that. Yeah, because, like, what do middle class people do? Go to work. And then go, like, maybe out to Applebee's.
Like, once a week.
Yeah, exactly. That's pretty low. That's a pretty low-risk lifestyle. If you're, like, flying private helicopters to dubious sex islands.
Yes!
Then you're living on the edge.
Exactly! And everyone's like, oh, no. Oh, we love the... Oh, why is this happening? It's a curse. You know what the curse is? Money! Aren't you the one that told me that, like, lottery winners always end up getting murdered?
Yeah, no, they either end up getting murdered or they end up just dying. There are statistics on this, I swear. I don't have them off the cuff, but lottery winners die young at, like, rates that are uncomparable to the general population because they're so high.
Yeah.
Like, the average lifespan of a lottery winner is something like 35.
Oh, my God! And look, everyone always says, like, oh, if I win the lottery, I'm going to live my regular life and not tell anybody. I'll keep going to work, but I'll have the money. Yeah, right. Yeah, right, you will. You're like, you're not going to buy a 12-pack of Bugattis Boog immediately.
Yeah, go fuck yourself. No way. I wouldn't do that. Are you kidding me?
All right. Before we wrap up the first segment, what would you do if you had $100 million?
I'm
trying to think of what I would do if I had $100 million. I think I would probably buy the Nintendo Switch that has Animal Crossing on it.
It's going to cost, okay, what are you going to do with your other $2 million?
Hey, what are you going to do with your money?
Sponsor a family in the Philippines. Just send them $1,000 a month. Just become someone's guardian. I'm going to learn Tagalog. I'm going to quit my job, learn Tagalog, and then sponsor a family in the Philippines for $1,000 in the month, and then I'm going to make them, like, the Tom Nook of their village. I'm not talking, like, not in Manila. I'm talking, like, 3-4 miles out. Like, the second world country part of the Philippines. And I'm going to send them, like, $1 million and be like, go rig a political election or something.
Oh, that sounds like fun. Wait a minute. So if you had $100 million, you're essentially turning the real world into Sim City.
Yeah.
That's cool. That's okay. I want a hair salon here, a police station here. I get to pick the mayor. That's cool as hell. Raise taxes, alien invasion, set a fire over here.
Fracking? Yeah, sure. Go do it.
Yeah, whatever. Fracking sounds good. All right, hey, look, that's it for our first one. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to LOUDEST Party. This is the only podcast that has two microphones that were bought at reasonable prices. Instagram models are starting podcasts now. Did you hear about that?
Have you tried to listen to them?
No, but I should do that. I should do that for next week's episode. I should review a podcast started during the quarantine because I follow a lot of these, like, professional hot women and a lot of them are starting podcasts now. I should try to listen to one. I'm sure it's going to be informative and educational.
I think it's depressing. I read a story once about, like, how a girl that had, like, 1 million Instagram followers couldn't even sell 30 t-shirts.
Oh, yeah, And I saw one of the ones I follow started a YouTube channel, and she had 180,000 followers on Instagram. She's like, I'm going to start a YouTube channel where I just talk about philosophy. And then now she has 1,700 subscribers. So I was like, oh, that must be devastating to your self-esteem.
But that must make you real happy that, like, some super hot Instagram models got brought back down to earth.
Yeah, it does.
I don't know why. it makes me happy, but it do.
People failing makes me happy.
People failing. People who have it better than me coming back down to earth. I'm like, oh, yes, the sweetest of nectars. Even though it's not like I'm getting any more popular.
Oh, no.
I'm not getting any richer. It's like, yeah, now we're both stuck in this hole, you dumb. And then I say the B word.
Yeah, whoever is pranking me with the Instagram followers, I appreciate it. I got like 3,000 Instagram followers overnight. I don't know where they all came from.
I think what happened is your Instagram link, it's Instagram.com/Sirancha.
Yeah,
Sierra
go
Rancho. Sirancha. You should give her a follow. It's a good follow. I think your Instagram URL must have gotten added to one of those, like, check out this hot chick message boards, or like a Reddit, like of like upcoming of like new faces. I think that like someone discovered you and is championing you.
I think I'm just getting hacked or something. Like somebody's pulling a prank on me.
I just don't see. It's like it would cost money to buy you Instagram followers.
That's true. Maybe they're trying to get me banned though, because if you buy followers, you get banned.
That's true. Somebody could be trying to do that. But the thing is, if you got banned and then you went out there and you were like, I got banned. Someone banned me from Instagram. Then you would get sympathy and even more followers.
Oh yeah, that's a lot. It's a lot to think about. It's a lot to take in. My least favorite part, have you ever gone to a virtual doctor's appointment?
Yes.
Let me tell you people, open back up the state. I don't care how many people get COVID. I'm never going to another virtual doctor's appointment again.
Okay. Now, I know you've gone to a couple of them. I mean, personally, the very few times I've done telemedicine, like, they're not a lot. Well, back then, they weren't allowed to prescribe anything. I'm guessing they're allowed to prescribe shit now.
They're not prescribing me anything new. I've been going to the doctor for a long time because I look very healthy, but I'm very, very sick on the inside. Mm-hmm. So they're not prescribing me anything new. They will give me refills. So okay. I don't know if that's like a rule where they're not allowed. I'm sure something. They have changed the rules or something, but God damn it. I hate it so much. It's fucking embarrassing. It's so fucking embarrassing to be sitting there talking about your problems to a webcam on some, whatever the HIPAA compliant version of Skype is. And the only thing I'm thinking is I cannot believe I am paying this much money for a fucking Skype call. I hate this. I hate virtual doctor's appointment. Fuck you. I'll go lick a Subway pole before I'll go to another goddamn virtual telemed.
At least they should be cam girling it up. Like, as they're asking about like your blood pressure and cholesterol, they should be like putting shoe on head, you know, putting a thing and a thing, unbuttoning a thing, buttoning up another thing. Like, give me my goddamn money's worth here.
Give me my goddamn money's worth. And half of my brain is like, we need to end this conversation as quickly as possible because this is fucking embarrassing. And the other half of my brain is like, no, you need to take the whole hour because you're going to be paying. You're paying your fucking deductible anyway. So you might as well sit here and cry at your fucking webcam like the pussy ass bitch that you are. Fuck you, telemed. Go fuck yourself.
Is it possible? Okay, now I'm starting to realize something. Is it possible that you don't hate telemedicine? Is it possible that you just don't like going to the doctor?
I don't know.
Let me just say this. Very few of your complaints have been about the... Is it that you can see yourself? Is that what you...
Yes, that is the big problem.
Okay. That has to be fixed. You're right.
No.
We have to find a way... Because in Zoom meetings, I turn myself off. Because if I could see myself, all I would be doing would be like judging like my widow's peak. Like, I don't have a widow's peak. I have a... husband is sick and dying. I have like a convalescent husband peak.
Oh, your hair looks good.
We know we're going to be a widow soon, but we're not quite there yet. And like, we're still going over for visits and we're pretending things are normal, but this old geezer is dying. Make room in the freezer for the geezer. That's what I'm doing on these fucking Zoom calls.
Anna Nicole Smith peak.
Yes, exactly. Goodness. So like, you got to find a way to turn yourself off.
I do. I think, you know what? I'm had that as an epiphany. I've never thought about that, but that definitely is what it is. Because, like, if you put a mirror in front of people, they are less likely to steal something because looking at yourself makes you more aware of like your actions and how they look to other people.
I heard a long time ago that if a serial killer is threatening to murder you, you are supposed to immediately tell him a bunch of details about your life. So, because serial killers see you as less than human. So you're supposed to be like, my name is Asterios Kokonos. I was born in 1976. My first job was at the National Scrabble Association. I love grilled chicken and I love chicken nuggets. I'm a big fan of the XCOM series of games. Have you heard this?
I believe it. I have not heard it anywhere, but I do believe it.
Okay. We're gonna pause real quick because I want to look this up.
That's a good idea.
All right. I couldn't find anything about that thing I'd heard.
That's okay. That happens.
But here's what I'm realizing, though. Because I heard that, like, in high school. So, like, I was watching the news, and someone was like, very quickly, tell a serial killer a bunch of personal private information about yourself. And now I'm realizing, what if that person on the news was a serial killer who's like, yeah, what you want to do is tell someone your name and address, how many family members you have, whether or not they're armed.
I don't know. I think I've played one too many icebreaker games that would make me want to kill someone more.
Yeah, I know. Does it sound realistic? Okay. All right. So if you're going to get killed by a serial killer, I don't know, have ashy skin. Like, have skin so bad that, like, it doesn't matter how many times you put the lotion on your skin, like, you'll never have the wrinkles out again.
You'll never, ever become a suit.
Yeah, don't you stop moisturizing now, listeners.
And do it for protect yourself.
It's exact. All right. What were we just talking about?
I don't know. Telemed or something.
Telemed. Okay.
Just a classic Sirancha ramble.
I like your rambles.
It's classic. I got another one for you in the zeitgeist if you want it. So you heard of this Hey Vina app?
No.
Okay, so there's an app on the App Store called Hey Vina. It's like Tinder for finding friends, and it's only for women. I've seen the download numbers. I know it's a sausage party in here. So the Hey Vina app, you can only be on it if you're a woman, and it's for finding friends in your area, like hot, sexy women who want to make friends near you. And let me tell you, this application, this is why I could never date again, because first of all, it's like getting the experience of being a man on Tinder.
Yikes.
Because you're constantly getting, like, rejected.
You get rejected for friendship?
Oh, yes. I get rejected frequently. And let me tell you, asshole. I just broke my retainer. Let me tell you, assholes.
Did you really just break your retainer?
No, I dropped my phone on it. It looks okay.
Okay, good. I know those things are expensive.
I heard a popping sound, and I was like, oh, God. Did I just irreparably fuck my teeth? Because I can't go to I can't go back. The orthodontist is closed. Anyway, so the Hey Vina app, if you're a woman, you should download it and give it a shot. Tell me if you have the same experience as I do, because it's like, and let me tell you, here's what I've realized on this app while using this app, because all my friends live in either Philadelphia or Atlanta, where they go to Georgia State and where tuition is handled by some dude on seeking arrangement that she only sees when she feels obligated to. Here's why I can never be on a dating app again. It's because you motherfuckers, you get one little taste of anime being in the acceptable, in the culture where, you know, it's kind of not weird to watch anime anymore, or it's not like really, you don't need to watch acid washed subtitled videotapes if you want to watch Dragon Ball Z now, right? So now everybody's typing, they're typing away in their little profiles. I love anime. You do not put in your profile on anything that you like anime if you mean you watched one season of fucking My Hero Academia 8 years ago. Okay? Because then when I swipe on you and I start talking about Orisuki, you can't immediately unblock me or block me like I'm the fucking weirdo. Like, I'm the fucking weirdo. Why is that show so popular? That show fucking sucks. You mind if I wild out real quick for a minute? Why is that show so popular? If every character on that show was a fucking cunt, I do not understand, except Sasanka, who did fucking nothing wrong and who deserves to win the harem battle. You know how little of a shit Orisuki gives about you? The ninth or tenth episode is a fucking clip show. You know how much little of a shit you need to give to have a clip show in an animated program? That's like a big middle finger to you. If you have no, here's the qualification standards for whether or not you get to put you like anime in your profile. If you've never sat and stared at a mal list and said to yourself, well, I guess I'll watch Citrus because it's the only thing that's not incest bait from A1 Pictures that looks interesting this season. Joke's on you. It's incest. If I had a nickel for every time, fuck A1 Pictures, all my homies hate A1 Pictures. If I had a nickel for every A1 Pictures anime that has come out that is about a teenage boy getting into sexually frustrating situations with a female family member who is not biologically related to him, I would have 2 nickels, which is not a lot, but it's fucking weird they did it 2 times, right?
It sounds weird to me.
Anohana is the only thing worth watching, and yes, I'm counting Aromanga Sensei. Don't at me. I don't care. I'm not watching that shit. I'm not watching your incest bait. Fuck off.
Okay, you're arguing like someone who is watching the incest stuff. I'm just pointing that out.
You'll notice
that, like, I'm not going on a podcast saying, I'll never watch your incest cartoons. I know their names. I know the studio that makes them, but I'll never watch your... It's like, you're protesting a little bit too much.
I watched this show about 2 years ago. It was called Citrus, and it's about a girl whose mom gets married to, she gets a stepsister, and then in the title cards, in the opening, like, song that they do on all of them, there is a tongue kiss, like an explicit open mouth tongue kiss between these two stepsisters, and I'm like, god damn it, is this another fucking incest show?
So obviously I watched all of seasons 1 and 2.
Yeah, so obviously,
by season 3 I'm like, I'm sick of the incest.
I gave up around episode 10 because it's like, just tell her you want to fuck your sister. I'm not thrilled about what's happening here, but just tell her, man. I can't deal with this anymore. I can't deal with this will they, won't they, fuck each other. And first of all, I love in the Aura Email manga when the brother and sister go and they get pictures, portraits taken of themselves wearing a tuxedo and a wedding dress, kissing, and their parents find it. And they decide, okay, Kyosuke, you're fucking moving out to an apartment until exams are over. And if you get an A, you can come back because you're getting a little too close to your sisters. I would whoop my kids' cheeks so fucking hard. They would never be able to sit fucking down if I found out my children were fucking each other. That is like 10 levels of lenient parenting. And it's treated like this big emotional thing. Like, no, you are lucky that you didn't get, there was any triple homicide in that apartment.
Okay.
After they found that.
Okay. I think that the real problem here is that they said you can move back in if you do well on a test. That's a very...
That's
the most Japanese thing I think I've ever heard. That's just like, that's like, look, I don't like that you're fucking your sister, but I will use this to make sure you get an A on your exams. I'm going to set up the sweetest possible plum for you to do well at your college entrance exams, or what the fuck?
You know, you're the exam you need to pass to stay in my house is the exam where you identify who is okay and not okay to have sexual relationships with. And let me tell you, it's a pretty easy exam to pass.
If it turned out that my kids were having an Orosuki style relationship, and God, I hope I said that right. I didn't.
You didn't.
Okay. What phrase am I looking for?
Ore emo.
If I found out that my kids were having an Ore emo style relationship, I would move Ore to the West Coast and emo to the East Coast. Like, I would change their phone numbers. I might send one of them to the Arctic Circle. And be like, you're going to be an ice core researcher. And then I'd send the other one to, like, the South Pacific. And you're going to find a cure for the hantavirus.
Yeah, I would have to permanently. I would either have to. The older one, I would have to send away forever, I think. I don't think that's, like, no, you can never have. Do not ever contact your sister again.
So I'm guessing Aura Emo does well on the test.
It's at the end of the series, their relationship is left to be ambiguous. So you don't know if they're fucking each other. Oh, Sayori, you deserve a better show.
So it was just like a brother sister fucking phase. Or was it two sisters?
It was brother and sister. One of them's 15. One of them's 17. I think. Yeah.
Okay.
That sounds about right.
Well, Sirancha.
Yeah.
I'm sorry that you clearly went on the Vita app and then found a girl that said she liked anime. And then for some reason got in her DMs and started talking about brother-sister fucking like it was normal.
Like if you...
Because clearly this is what's happened, right? Like, you're not bringing this up out of nowhere. This is like our 63rd episode. You didn't spend 62 episodes talking about what you would do if a brother and if your kids fucked. This is something you did or said, isn't it?
Yeah, okay, let me tell you exactly what happened.
Okay.
I matched on the Heyvina app with this girl, and her profile was like, message me about anime. And so I get a slip in the DMs. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, hey, what are you watching this season? She's like, I haven't watched anything since Boruto. I was like, blocked. Immediately blocked. This isn't fucking Tinder, you stupid bitch. I'm not going to pretend that I watch Boruto or One Piece or any one of these normie-ass shonen shows that go for 600 fucking episodes. Get the fuck out of here. I hate you.
Wow. Okay. So maybe the problem isn't that people are rejecting you. Maybe the problem is that you are clearly rejecting people, you anime classist. You could have brought her in and shown her the world of subs. You could have like slowly introduced her to better and better anime until you had a fellow weeb. Although, unless you get to fuck them at the end, it does seem like a lot of work.
Yeah, no, gate's closed. I am gatekeeping. The gate has been locked.
The thing I hate about the Heyvina app is, first of all, I don't know who Vina is. But secondly, it's just like, what if you set up a thing where you were like going to meet up? Like, what if you got stood up on a friend date?
Oh, man, well, I would fucking kill myself.
Yeah, it's like one thing to get stood up on like Tinder, but it's like, you know, I wasn't even looking to fuck tonight and I got stood up.
Yeah.
It's like my personality got stood up tonight. Other thing I'm going to say about Heyvina, though, is, I mean, to take us all the way back to serial killers, how is this not just like serial killer Christmas? It's like, I'm a girl too. Let's be friends. Let's meet up in an alley and just be friends. We can trust each other because we're both girls, right? Stab, 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 stab. New suit of clothes for Christmas. 101 Dalmatians, more like 101 cremations, because you're going to have so many fucking teenage girl skeletons in your clin at home. And so many great new sets of clothes.
I feel like it would be really hard to kill someone in New York City. Like, I have no doubt in my mind all the murders would happen in the suburbs, because like, think about how many times you're isolated in the suburbs. You have to park your car, you go to the grocery store, you're walking, you're alone, it's dark. That's murder bait, baby. But like, you have to really go out of your way to be isolated in New York City.
I totally agree. But one of the things that often gives away the murder is the smell of the bodies being cremated in the trunks of cars. Like, in New York City, it always smells terrible anyway. So, like, if you're burning a body down in your basement, it's like, well, I don't know, you were probably burning a raccoon down in the basement yesterday, and you'll be burning a tire there tomorrow.
But, like, how are you going to kill him? Fun fact for everyone who's never been, we don't have alleyways in New York.
Alleyways.
The buildings are built so close together that there are no alleyways.
No, that's very expensive real estate. I don't know why we would just have them there for the Ninja Turtles
like a murder,
to hop in and out of.
A murder slide.
God damn it. Okay. I'm sorry that you didn't find any Heyvina friends. I'm also kind of not sorry because I don't want you getting murdered.
Joke's on you. That's all I'm looking for.
God, you millennials.
Give me for a nice stab in the kidney.
All right. We'll be right back after this with our third segment. Welcome back to the Loudest Podcast. I got the antibody test.
How did it go?
Well, not great. But The first thing I want to do is tell people what the antibody test is in case they don't know. What's the antibody test?
It's the test that tests your antibodies for COVID.
Right. Why would you get it?
So you could tell if you had COVID.
Exactly. And why would it be important to know if you had COVID or
because
not?
Because if you have COVID, have had it, then you get to lick as many Subway poles as you want.
Exactly. It's like, it's generally speaking with a virus, you can only get it once. And after that, you create these little antibodies in your system. And those antibodies are a genetic marker that says, I had it, it's gone. I took the antibody test and I did not have the COVID antibody.
No!
I know. Which sucks. It rules, but it sucks. It sucks because now I can't visit my mom for Mother's Day. Because, like, I've never had the COVID. Which means, like, I can have it right now. So, like, I can't go visit my elderly parents. We can't go get... We can't make French toast. We can't watch Judge Judy. I can't have any parent time. Fucking sucks. But on the other hand... Good on me for not getting COVID.
Yeah, no, you did take it very seriously. I was convinced that we'd both had it.
Me too.
But I guess not, because if you don't have it, obviously I don't have it.
Yeah, I'm on the subway every day, going to work. And remember, at the beginning of this, the CDC was like, you don't gotta wear a mask.
It's fine.
Yeah, at the beginning of this, the CDC is like, mask, schmask, don't go cray cray.
Try to limit the number of subway poles you're licking, but don't stop altogether.
Fucking exactly. At the beginning, the CDC is like, go to work, have fun, make out with people, everything's cool, baby. The last thing we want is a panic. At the beginning of this whole mess, the CDC was like the mayor from Jaws. It's like, yes, I know that Jaws is out there eating people, but what if there's a panic and it ruins our summer economy and now we can't, now we'll lose all our seaside tourism business. I'm the mayor from Jaws.
No more pictures of Christie's entire family hanging out on the beach.
Yup, exactly. And the Christie's are like the ultimate snack for Jaws.
Oh, yes, they are.
It's like you got to eat Grimace and Grimace's whole family of mini Grimaces. It's like you get to eat like a 6-piece McNuggets and a giant McNugget.
It's like if you just got your shark, you're like, holy shit, are we on that Bermudian island where there's the pigs in the water?
Yes, exactly. So I'm going to work. I'm like I'm fucking licking doorknobs. I'm making out with the DoorDash guy. I'm doing fucking everything. I don't got the COVID. I don't got the COVID. Scary thing about the COVID though. People in their 30s and 40s are now getting strokes. Sudden strokes from the COVID. Have you heard about this?
I have.
Yeah. Like apparently totally normal, healthy ass person. One day they just boom, stroke out. And then I was reading some article about a doctor looking at, like, as he was dissecting blood clots in this dude's brain, more blood clots were forming in real time around the clot he had just disabled, which reminded me a lot of that, like, surgery game on the Nintendo Wii.
Trauma Center, Second Opinion.
Exactly! And it's like, Second Opinion is you're even more dead because of the COVID. So then I was like, God damn it.
You know what I heard is what? That Zoomers, it's our time! It's time to rise up, Zoomers. We're going to hide the cure in Minecraft so none of you can get it.
Oh, speaking of Minecraft. Okay, I got to pull this up.
Oh, I'm so excited. Yeah, Zoomers, it's our time. We're going to lick all the doorknobs. We're going to be sneezing on everybody.
All right.
You thought you were safe because you remember the 90s? Nope, not anymore.
All right. Speaking of Minecraft, there's an Am I the Asshole? It has 18,000 upvotes. And you want to hear about the awards it has? Oh, it has so many awards. It has two poop knife awards. It has two triple ply toilet paper awards, three a diamond in the poo awards, five stonks falling awards, three press F awards, and the Golden Throne Award.
Are these awards good or bad?
I don't know. It's, I mean, they must be good because you have to spend money to give them.
I would spend money to tell somebody on Reddit they're fucking stupid.
Oh, yeah, I mean, it's, it does have the Wholesome Seal of Approval Award, but it has 14 Yikes Awards and it's a monkey making a yikes face. So here's the thread. It's called, Am I the Asshole for Deleting My Son's Minecraft World? and welcome to another edition of The Loudest Assholes Troll Court.
Okay.
I want to know whether or not this person is trolling because I can't tell.
I'm ready.
All right. Am I the asshole for deleting my son's Minecraft world? I have two children, a 9-year-old son and a 6-year-old daughter. My son had a Minecraft world where he built quite an impressive castle on an island, which he was very proud to show to me. Since school was canceled, he has had issues with waking up on time. He is a 9-year-old son, by the way. He is supposed to wake up at 7 each morning, but for the past month, he's been sleeping in till around 9 or 10 a.m. I always set an alarm for him, my 9-year-old son, but he sleeps right through it. I don't wake him up because waking himself up is a skill that he needs to learn. I told him about 2 weeks ago that there are going to be consequences for him if he continues to sleep in every morning. At first, he understood. He was waking up on time every morning. For the past week or so, he had fallen back into old habits. I told him yesterday, this is his final warning. Today, he slept in until 11. So I followed through with my warning and went on the computer and deleted his favorite Minecraft world. I also took away his computer privileges for the next month. When I told him I did this, he started screaming and crying. He told me that he had spent a whole year working on that world, and he's very distraught that he's never going to see it again. He has been crying and sobbing throughout the day and has refused to eat any of his meals. Reddit, am I the asshole for deleting my son's Minecraft world? Let's get that out of the way. Do you think this guy's an asshole for doing
this? Of course. Why didn't he just take the computer?
This doesn't
make any sense. This is fake. This never happened. This is fake as shit.
Wait, to be fair, does Minecraft have some sort of cloud access where he could access his Minecraft world from his phone?
I have never in my life played Minecraft, but I'm 100% sure that no one who's old enough to have a 9-year-old son knows how to effectively remove a Minecraft world from this plane of existence.
That is the first clue to me that this is a troll. I, Asterios Coconuts, I know how to delete Minecraft from a computer. I can go to like the settings, remove programs, delete it like that. I don't know how to delete a world. It would take me a while to figure out.
The only gem, the only diamond in this sandstorm of bullshit is that maybe that's what he means. Maybe this fucking boomer ass dad deleted the Minecraft, like the little icon. It was like, I deleted Minecraft.
Okay. I hope that is the case. I'm looking for OP responses. Give me 1 second. Comments. Oh, no comments. That could mean it's real. Because if I'm a troll and I tried my hand at Am I the Asshole trolling, I'm getting in there trying to stoke the fire. I'm calling people Karen. I'm defending myself. Like, I'm trying to get it going on with people. But no comments means maybe I felt so ashamed that I had to leave the internet.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. If this is real, and I think there's a very, very slim chance that it is. It's some dad is like, okay, I'm going to delete the Minecraft world. And then he just takes it and drags it and puts it in the recycling bin. It's like, Minecraft world deleted.
Okay. God, I hope that this is boomer parentage. The number one comment here is, you're the asshole. Parenting is more about finding ways to get your child to succeed than negative punishment. Not only will your goal of having him wake up not be met, you've created additional hardship on your child during these unprecedented times. He's 9. The punishment did not fit the crime.
Oh, no, it did not. Oh, my God. I cannot imagine. Holy shit. Can you imagine, like, working on a book or something for a year, and then your partner trashes your hard drive or something? Oh, my God. I would fucking kill myself.
I'm leaning towards, if you had threatened to do this explicitly, I think it would be a little bit better. If you'd been like, if you don't start waking up on time, I see you spending a lot of time in your Minecraft world, I'm gonna have to delete your Minecraft world because you need to spend more time in the real world. Like, You can't just make the punishment nebulous. Like, if you don't start waking up on time, terrible things will happen to the people you love.
And something irreparable is going to happen to your Minecraft bees.
Yes, exactly. like creep. I'll find a way to stop the creepers from destroying your castle forever. you gotta be specific.
Yeah. Oh, man. I would just take the computer. Like, clearly that was an option, because he did that in addition to deleting the Minecraft server.
That's a really fucking good point. That's a really good point. That would be like, not only am I taking away your access to the Animal Crossing island, but I also talked to Isabel, and Isabel's making all your favorite residents leave. Rex, Cody, that cat that's also an influencer pop star, they've all left the island.
Yeah.
I made Isabel tell them you hated them.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. Somebody do that. Somebody be like, am I the asshole for punishing my 6-year-old by evicting his favorite villager?
Wait. By somebody, do you mean us?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Let's do it.
We're doing that. We're doing that right after this episode is done.
Oh, my God. I'm so excited.
Oh, my God. Quick island update. I think it might be fun to just like let people know what's going on our island every week. Because it's like, this way you don't have to play Animal Crossing, but you can still talk about it and you fucking Slack chats at work.
Yeah.
The fuckable dog is here. Isabel's here. That dog that everybody wants to put in is here.
She
showed up and she's running the village center. She's running the village services center. She's here now. She's working right next to Tom Nook. It's super adorable.
Everybody loves the fuck dog, and I love the fuck dog, and I'm happy she's here.
Also, I did a little bit of Googling on the fuck dog. Apparently, Isabel is a queer icon.
Is she gay?
Not gay. Queer. Because Isabel develops a crush on the player, regardless of the player's gender identity. So if you're a little boy in the Animal Crossing world, or a little girl in the Animal Crossing world, Isabel is just super into you. I think the thing that Isabel is really attracted to is power and bells.
Isabel is a reverse furry icon.
I don't know what that... Okay, elaborate on this just a little bit more.
Okay, so Isabel's a dog, right? Uh-huh. And she wants to fuck a human. And normally when you're a human and you want to fuck a dog, you're called furry. But Isabel's a reverse furry.
Yes! Oh my God! She's a humie!
Humie.
You're fucking right!
Time to kink shame the Animal Crossing dog.
She's super into fucking people. She's a peepee. Wow, this is goddamn real. I never even thought of that. Okay, so Isabel's here. She wants to fuck... Blathers is here. We've already talked about Blathers being here. Rex showed up on the island. Rex is a lion. I haven't really figured out Rex's personality yet.
He just seems like he's stoned all the time.
Is that his thing?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Rex is here. Also, a fucking hippie named like Dave, man, showed up. And he was like, whoa, I heard about your island. It's pretty cool. If you ever want to visit my island, that would be totally neat. So... you can go to, so there's a ticket for his island at the airport. We go to the airport, says, you want to fly to Dave's island? Sure. We get there. It's the middle of the night. The island only has one house on it.
It sucks. Harvey's island fucking blows.
Harvey, that's his name. Harvey's standing outside. Harvey goes, and this is not an exaggeration. Hey, thanks for coming to my island. He's the only one there. Why don't you come on in and I can take some pictures of you? And you're like, okay. And you get in and he's like, it's a lot of fun. I love inviting people over here all by themselves, flying here. And I just love taking pictures of them. And obviously, you've seen our character. Our character is clearly a child.
Yeah. Give me your passport.
Yeah.
To take your photo, I need to take your passport first.
I'll hold on to this in case you lose it. Here, let me hang on to you. Like, oh, and also, Harv's like, I have all sorts of outfits. If you want to change into any of the outfits I have so I can take your picture, I have 6 different rooms where I can take your picture in any of these fun outfits. One of them looks like an exposed brick nightmare room.
Yeah, my last name used to be Terry. What about it? Sure, I used to work for American Apparel. Who gives a shit?
That's weird. And then Harv goes like, I'm just going to go outside and catch some fresh air. Why don't you just take any pictures you want, as many as you want, all by yourself? you know he's behind some sort of two-way mirror, just cranking his dog penis, just like making that red rocket launch.
Oh, yeah, he's hoping that Isabel comes over.
Oh, my goodness gracious. And then, like, eventually you figure out that, like, you're allowed to invite your friends. So it's like, you can invite anyone you want. And then after you leave the island, he's like, I did a special photo session just with your friends. If you want to buy these pictures of your friends. Yeah. And now I'm realizing now it's like not only he's jerking it, it's also some kind of timeshare thing where it's like, if you want to buy a picture of the cat, it's 2,000 bells. Like, all right. Is this like that thing in high school where it was like, you got accepted to our most exceptional students catalog. We're going to put your name in the super students guide. Why does anybody have that guide? Why? You know what I'm talking about with the super students guide?
I have no idea.
All right, this must have been like a 90s thing. It was very similar to the class ring. Every single student in the country got a letter in the 90s that said, your name has been selected for our exceptional students guide. It's only exceptional students get to be published in it. We're going to put your name in it for free. Now, obviously, you want a copy of this guide, right? Well, that's $29.95. If you want five copies of it so you can send it to your family members, it'll be like five for a hundred. And it's just like a weird book of names. It's not like anyone's using this book for reference. No one's like, hey, Laura, get me the five most exceptional students in my small town, stat. Oh, luckily, I've got one of those exceptional student guides right here. It's weird.
That's fucking weird. Holy shit. That sounds like a scam.
Yeah, it was a super goddamn scam.
Wow.
Yeah, but I'll tell you something. It's not a scam. Patreon.com/Asterios.
We're recording another Dark Side Jills next weekend. God, I'm so fucking excited. It's going to be all about 90 Day Fiancé and the art, the artistic beauty that I've seen the download numbers, you fucking sausage. I know, no men watched it, but you can get educated on why this is the best show ever made. Dark Side Jills, just $2.
Sirancha is trying to tell me about, what's his name? No Neck Ed?
Yeah, No Neck Ed.
Okay. If you've seen No Neck Ed trending on Twitter, apparently No Neck Ed is a character on 90 Day Fiancé, which is like the most popular reality show in the world right now.
He's the breakout star.
He's the breakout star. And Sirancha shows me, she's watching the video and she's like, hey, take a look at this. She turns around her computer. No Neck Ed is giving like an Asian woman a foot massage.
Yeah, No Neck Ed is dating Rose Marie. No Neck Ed is 54 years old and is dating 23-year-old Rose Marie from the Philippines. So y'all already know what the fuck's going on there.
Right. We don't need to say anything else. And it's like, she's like, hey, take a look at this. And, like, she's showing it to me, and I just tell her, I want to know nothing else about this. I go, I'm putting up a firewall right here on information about No Neck Ed and the girl from the Philippines that he's marrying in 90 days or is married to for 90 days. I don't know how. I don't want to know how. You guys leave that on Dark Side Chills.
Well, if you, listener, want to know how, head on over to patreon.com/Asterios. Just $2. Next week, we got a brand new episode coming out. It's going to be good shit.
Yeah. That's it for this week's episode of the Loudest Pod. All right, next week we have to get back to voicemails.
Yeah.
We haven't done them for 3 weeks. We've been really lazy about the voicemails. You can leave a voicemail at 848-863-5343. Or you can write us a letter or a note at theloudestpodcast@gmail.com. Thank you for listening. We'll talk to you later.
Bye.